Can you all hear me?
No!
Yes!
No need to shout. Inhabitants of Caerleon, sitting around the amphitheatre, seeing their local troops displayed. All the orders are given in Latin.
The one with the crescent in the back goes side to side.
Now the Roman legionaries are moving out.
They're in charge as well.
And we will describe their kit to you.
Ladies and gentlemen,
our Roman legionary soldiers. These are Roman citizens of Rome. They had to be Roman citizens when they joined the Roman army. They enlisted for a period of 25 years. During that 25 years, they were not allowed to make legal marriages. And the actual process of enlistment was an automatic form of divorce. So we will take male recruits immediately after the display. Taking a closer look at the equipment of legionary soldiers, you can see they wear large helmets to protect their heads, large cheekpieces either side the face, big neck guards at the back of the helmet, and a reinforcement on the front to take sword blows that might come down on the front of the helmet. Most of them are wearing a type of armour, which we call arca segmentata, made of segments of metal which are riveted together on leather straps. This makes the armour quite flexible and quite easy for the soldier to move inside. For many years, when I say we, the academics did not understand how this armour worked, but two and a half suits of this armour were found at the Roman supply station on Hadrian's Wall, and from that time we've been able to reconstruct this type of armour accurately. The weight of one of these armours is about 10 kilos in weight. Around the bottom plates of the armour you've got a military belt, a leather belt with decorative metal plates riveted to it. In the front of the belt you get this peculiar apron, which may be for the protection of lower stomach and private parts. Though we find this more psychological than practical. On the feet we've got very tough leather sandals, very thick soles in the sandals. Some of them have got more of a boot type footwear, but most of them have got this type of very heavy sandal with a thick sole, with numerous hobnails in the bottoms of the sandals. Needs to protect the leather and stop the leather being worn away. Also gives a good grip on surfaces such as we are on today. The legionary carries in his left hand a large shield called a scutum, which is made of laminated wood. And today we refer to laminated wood as plywood. So you have thin layers of wood with the grain going in different directions. This makes very strong construction, and also because it's glued in a curved shape, it stays in that shape. The shield is then covered in linen or leather, and the design painted directly onto the front of the shield. And from the second Tacitus's writing, he suggests that because two legionaries were able to approach an enemy legion by picking up their shields, it suggests each legion had a design which was peculiar to each legion. In the centre of the shield is a large metal boss which protects the single hand grip that they use to carry and manoeuvre in the shield. The Roman usually was well equipped with weapons. First of all, he has a javelin. The javelin is a throwing weapon, so this is a shock weapon. Imagine if you engage the Roman army in battle, you'd get volleys of these javelins thrown at you. This was then followed by the short sword, the soldiers would draw their short swords, these short stabbing and thrusting swords. Never use a shield to knock you in the face, knock your balance, and stick you particularly into the stomach with a short sword. And finally, our left side, another killing weapon from its shaping can only be a stabbing weapon. It's called a pugil or dagger. And each legionary carried one of these. Just to confuse everybody, today legionaries were organized into centuries of 80 men. So 80 men in a century, not 100.
We also have a group of legionaries here who've got marching packs on their shoulders.
The shield covers you see, leather with leather shield covers. They've got packs on their shoulders, just like our soldiers when they go to Afghanistan today, take their big packs with their bits and pieces they're going to need on campaign, so the Roman soldier would expect to carry his equipment with him. He's got 3 days' supply of food, he's got a blanket, he's got a cloak, he's got spare sandals, all the bits and pieces that he would need on the march. They were expected to march some 20 miles in five hours, which is quite a fast march. The gentlemen in front of you now with the oval shields are Roman auxiliary soldiers. There are as many Roman auxiliary soldiers in the Roman army as there were legionaries. These are non-Roman citizen soldiers who recruited for a period of 25 years, and at the end of their 25 years would receive Roman citizenship, which was also passed to their families as well. It's the Roman auxiliaries you would find in the smaller forts in the valleys in Wales, and indeed the Roman auxiliaries who manned Hadrian's Wall. Their equipment tends to be more simple than the legionaries. They are on less pay. They have simple brass helmets, in this case. Got mail shirts. For some reason or other, you never see them in the strip armour. They've got double belts supporting their swords and daggers. They've also got a flat oval shield, more suitable maybe for skirmishing, and a stabbing spear rather than a throwing javelin. They were organised as well into centuries of 80 men, but also into smaller regiments of about 500 or 800 men. We've also got various officers attached to the contingent. First of all, they have a signifer or standard bearer. You carry this standard to show the men their own standard to follow, just like a flag is used as a rallying point in the British Army some 150 years ago. So this standard would act as a rallying point to show the 80 men of the century attacked to him where to come together in battle. You can see all musicians and standard bearers wear animal skins over their helmets. In this gentleman's case, it's a European brown bear he wears over the top of his helmet. He's followed by a horn player called a cornican, who carries this large circular horn called a cornu. This is used to relay commands in battle and on the march. This cornu is based on several that were found in Pompeii and now in the Museum of Naples in Italy. It would have been used not only on the march, but also in the Roman amphitheatre and the Roman games, and indeed at Roman religious ceremonies. You can see he's got a wolf skin over the top of his helmet. Next gentleman carries a flag. This flag shows you which legion the men have come from. And as is appropriate to where we are today, the base of the 2nd Legion, so he's carrying the flag 2nd Legion Augusta. And this legion was based here at Caerleon for many, many years. And once again, he's got a European brown bear over his helmet. European brown bears can go from anything from black to a very light brown. We've also got a chap here carrying the face of the Emperor, called an imago, because he carries an image. And in this case, the Emperor on this image is the Emperor Vespasian. Very closely, you've got run over there. So he's carrying the face of the Emperor, as you can see. The second in command of a century was called the Optio. So called because he was chosen by the centurion, it was therefore the centurion's option to choose him. And he is, if you like, a centurion in waiting.
His main badge is a rank that we have evidence for, the staff that he kept is, north of the silver ring on his right hand. Also, we've given him a large crest and feathers to make him pick him out. And also, he carries the orders of the day in a satchel. The equipment that I'm wearing is that of a Roman centurion of this time. You can always tell the centurion because he's the only one whose crest goes from side to side, a transverse crest on the helmet. And the crest you're on view today are mainly made of horsehair, though you can see some feathers are on the sides of some of the other ranks' helmets. Other badges are rank for the centurion of the greaves that he wears on his legs, really not to protect his legs but to show he's an officer of some importance. I also have a cloak on my left shoulder. Also, I've got medals on my chest called Falerae, which are awarded for bravery in battle. And these can be awarded in sets of five, seven, or nine. And also, the tops on the shoulders. These are also given to Roman soldiers as military awards. And finally, I would always carry a vine staff, which is part of my badge of office, but would also be used on the men for what we call casual corporal punishment. In fact, there was a centurion on the Rhine whose nickname Cato Ultram, which means fetch me another, and he was always breaking his vine sticks on the backs of the legionary soldiers. We've looked at infantry so far, but we're lucky today to have two cavalrymen with us. We'll get them into the arena now. Our own horses work very hard compared with horses we use today. They're quite small mounts. And here they come. Go on, let's give a round of applause. Let's not make it half-hearted. So you can see the horses have... Everybody goes for horses. You can see the riders are equipped with male shirts. They've got helmets to protect their heads. Very decorative helmets with the image of human hair beaten into them. Carry shields on the left side. They have a stabbing spear. They also have a long slashing sword. The ponies or horses themselves have, as you can see, decorative saddle cloths with decorative pendants hanging in front and back of the horse. But the most noticeable thing you'll see on the Roman cavalrymen is the fact they're riding with no stirrups. Now, this thought for a very long time that Roman cavalry couldn't be very effective because they rode with no stirrups. But then it was realized when a gentleman called Peter Connolly reconstructed the Roman saddles. We realised that these hot saddles with a horn in each corner keeps the man firmly seated upon the horse and means that he can fight, stab, and be as ineffective as a man with using stirrups. And then later on you'll see this in action. Different sections of the men are operating on different types of exercise. You can see some with wooden swords and basket-shaped shields. These wooden swords would in fact be weighted with lead to make them twice the weight of a normal fighting sword. Another group are practicing throwing people. Another group are being drilled. As we said earlier, all the orders are given in Latin. Sin, dex, sin, dex, sinister dexter, left right. A couple of auxiliaries are sparring with the wood peeler. Roman troops who are always exercising, make them good at it.
and also keep them out of trouble with their idle hands. One of the Roman writers says their drills were bloody battles, and their battles bloody drills. It's thought that the Roman army was the first army to actually march in step. The other cavalry are carrying on to demonstrate some exercises. Not only were you training the cavalry man, you were also training the cavalry horses. Horses usually expects to see a stationary target, and it will shy if the target moves. But these horses have got to be trained to actually go for men. Going to demonstrate the stabbing pasta. See how the horns of the saddles can remain nice and firmly in the saddle. Stirrups weren't necessary. Probably this first horse is about the size of a traditional Roman pony. It wouldn't have been much bigger than that. Up in from Malta yesterday just to ride here this weekend. We're going back on Monday. Never turn. They're exercising their sword craft with human heads. We couldn't get any human heads this afternoon, so we're using cabbages.
Targets.
department. Everyone in the guard clamours to be a human target. I think these two upset the Centurion last night. Crafty. See how difficult it is to make a horse charge a moving target like a man. They have to be trained to it. Yeah, come on, give us some encouragement. This is crazy. Come on. Who are you rooting for? The horse or the soldiers? Men are now reassembling, and we'll show you some drill and battle tactics. Charge using their swords at the enemy. Well, we've dropped the peanut, we're not going to throw them at you. Can't even want to. Standards out of the way. Are the battle group for the famous Testudo or Toth? This has been used for approaching towns and fortifications. And once they reach, they could just immediately drop the shields, fan out, and then attack. You'll see the auxilia are taking up on either side just to protect the tortoise. Absolutely essential that you keep in step for this. You can see the protection it does give. Very strong formation. Well done. Give them that. It's very hot up there now, the daylight today. Moving out into battle line, draw their swords. You see the swords are now held up in the battle position, face forwards at waist height, and the shields are being lifted up to the battle position. The whole of the man's body is covered, and each shield helps protect the man next to him. Tell your men to keep their line. Very difficult. You want to line out, especially when you're carrying a shield.
Is 13 stroke always in Latin? It does sound like Latin to me.
We're going to offload some Roman artillery.
You did fire Roman artillery.
Gunpowder hadn't been invented yet. You shoot it. The propulsion is provided by skeins of rope and torsion. Sometimes human hair was used, which is very good in torsion, for good elasticity.
Can you see the gate?
Three types of artillery weapon here. To the left of the arena, we have a ballista. This fires fairly small rocks, depending on the size of the ballista, so the size of the rock. So these fired small rocks. Just being wound up now. We have two catapulters in the centre. Rather like a medieval crossbow, they fire bolts. Again, it's all in torsion. You can see if you look carefully that there's rope in torsion. One of the lights on Omega. As you can see, it would be useful for firing into cities.
We also have some archers.
Using composite bows.
Wow. They go, don't they?
Range of a catapult to the maximum range is about a quarter of a mile.
Those are the cheap seats.
The places where you get caught with an arrows.
The right-hand side with the single arm. It's quite a small one. They could be very big. They can also be quite dangerous to the operators. We do know from history that an Onager crew was wiped out by its own Onager when it misfired. So we have to be very careful with these.
Was that the ballista?
Yes.
I like the biggest.
Well, you've got there, Becky.
I like the one on the right.
That was the one on the right. When the Jews occupied the fortress of Masada, the Romans besieged them and fired large onagers at them. And of course, the Jews could see lumps of rock coming, so they tended to put straw mats over the side of the walls, which helped to cushion them. Then the Romans decided they would paint the lumps of rock they were throwing blue. Good example of early camouflage, so they couldn't be seen.
As long as you don't get wiped out.
Well,
they are dangerous.
What is there shooting? Is it some melons?
No, it's just a little bit of a bounce on the top.
If you look at the larger of the catapulter now, it's being set up for a high shot. You can see now the maximum range of the bolt. I understand we're going to go for the ballista first. That's set up for a high shot as well. Ballista on the left. Now going for the catapulter high trajectory.
Go to the one in the middle. See it?
Ooh. Oh. Right, we haven't lost that one. It cost about £25 to replace one, Raj.
To salute the standard at the end of our display. Don't forget we should be up on our cap. Come talk to us up there, have a look at the leather tents. Horses out, shall I say, ponies will be up there for 10 minutes or so for your children to come and pat the pony. But remember, a horse bites in one end and kicks in the other, so do be careful. And ladies in particular, come up there and grab yourself a Roman soldier and examine his armor and equipment.
Means white in Latin.
My friend?
And your friend. I think it was called the Dexter.
Is that because he's right, do you think?
You don't know anyone called the Dexter, do you?
Could you help me on the...
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I think we probably have time to go and do both. I want to be a surprise.